Last Sunday we talked about church not being a building, but church is people. It's people, that we're part of the family of God, this great big second family, and that as part of the family of God, we're part of a new community of disciples, that we are living signs of the gospel as we live and as we work and as we worship in our world. There are different pictures given in the Bible of the church, of the as we gather together as people. And the other one we talked about a little bit last week was that we're part of the body of Christ. And that's been on my mind a lot this past week, that we are part of the body of Christ. What is a body? What is a body? Well, a body is, first of all, it's alive. Body has different parts. It has arms, it has legs, there's eyes, nose, ears, there's a head on the body. Each part has a different function. Each part of the body is important. And when one part isn't functioning the way it is, the rest of the body, the whole body struggles. My cousin's son, Benjamin had surgery this past week on his eyes. We've mentioned him before. He has a tumor on the optical nerve, and so it's been really difficult to try to do a whole lot. And so they did a very delicate surgery and felt that it was very successful. But as he's been coming out of surgery now and waking up, there's things going on that they're not being able to explain right now. One part of the body, that part, this eye isn't working quite right, and it's really affecting the rest of his body as well. Each body part has an important function and a different function. And we need each part of the body. The body parts move together. They act and they do according to their function and their purpose. And most of the time, the body works smoothly and capably in what it does. We're able to go places. We're able to accomplish things. We work, we visit, whatever we do it quite effortlessly. We don't think, okay, I'm not going to move my arm. It just happens. It just happens. In 1 Corinthians 12:27, it says, "You are the body of Christ, and each one of you is a part of it." You are the body of Christ, and each one of you is a part of it. We as a church here are part of the body of Christ. Church is alive. It's made up of people. It's not an institution. And like body parts, each one of us is a needed part of the body. Now, there are about 14 people here this morning. We're all different. We all look different. We like to do different things. We have different abilities. If I asked Marion to play the songs for the singing this morning, it would have sounded very differently than if I played them, because I play piano and Marion doesn't. If I asked one of you to do something that I could ask one of you to do something that I'm not able to do, and it'll look very different. We're all different. We have different abilities. But together we form one body as the body of Christ. Now, we don't always function together the way we should. We don't always function together smoothly and perfectly, as Joel has brought to our attention already. But as followers of Jesus Christ, we're being formed into the body of Christ, into part of his body. And that means that there are times when there are rough edges. That means there are times when we have disagreements, when there is unity. But we are being formed together into the body of Christ. And in Colossians 1:18, Paul writes that Christ is the head of the body, the church. The head is a very, very important part of the body. It holds the most important body part, the brain. And when I was looking up this week, I knew a few things that the brain does, but just making sure that the brain helps us survive. It helps us to think. It helps us to remember. It helps us to breathe. The brain is connected to the rest of the body by nerves. Those nerves help the body and make the body function. For example, if my eye saw a ball coming to me very quickly, very fast, my eye will send a message to the brain. The brain will process that information, and the brain will send a command back through the nerve to the eye that will make the rest of my body move, whether it's to get out of the way or whether it's to catch the ball. The head is a very important part of the body, and we are told that as the body of Christ, that Christ is the head. That means that he's the leader. He's sovereign. We sang songs this morning about Christ being on the throne, that he reigns. The head as Christ is the head, he's the source of the church's life. He guides us and he governs us, his body. And as a body connected to the head, we're supplied with life and with energy, with power. Christ, as the head of the church, supplies nourishment to the whole body and helps the body grow. That's all of us as we grow together. And together with Christ, we are one living being. That's just marvelous. When I was thinking about this week, this whole picture of being the body with Christ as the head, we're one living being together as we work together. We're also a visible manifestation, a sign to the world of Jesus. As we function together, as we go out into our world, we are a sign of Jesus to the world, the ways of Jesus as we follow Jesus. We carry out Christ's purposes and his functions and his work in this world. We get our commands, our directions from the head as he leads the way. So it's very important then to stay connected to the head so that we can be a healthy and vibrant church filled with all the fullness of Christ. Like I said, I just think that's such a marvelous picture of who we are in Christ. And how important it is to stay connected to the head, how much we need Jesus, and how much we need each other, how much we need those nerve impulses, his messages to be flowing into us so we can fulfill Christ's purposes as he leads us and as he desires. We're a unique expression of the body of Christ here in Eyebrow Mennonite Church. There's no other church quite like us. Each church is unique. And we gather together as the people of God, as the body of Christ, and we expect, and I hope you come, expecting that you are going to experience God in our presence as we gather together, that God is here, that God is in our midst, and that when we come and gather together, that we expect that we are going to meet with God, that God is going to impact us, that we expect that the power of the Holy Spirit is going to flow through our lives, that we expect to hear God speak to us as we meet together, that we expect that God is going to give us guidance and wisdom to do all that we are called to do. And we can have confidence that God will give us guidance into all that he desires us to do. We can have confidence that God is with us and that we can rely on him to direct us and that he will empower us to do what he's calling us to do because we're attached to him, to the head. We can expect that. We can come with expectations. Now this afternoon we're having our annual meeting, and this is the start of a new year. And I always like the start of a new year. It's a good time to look back. It's a good time to look at who we are. I was going to try to talk to Orlando a little about who are we? Why was this church even started? What was the purpose of it? It's good to look at who we are, where we came from. What are God's plans and purposes for us? What did we do this past year? What are we looking towards for the future? And again, our work and our service and our purpose is unique. It's custom fit for us who are part of this church and this church in this particular community where we're located. We aren't the same as the Free Methodist Church and the United Church. We each have our unique are made up of unique people, and we have a unique purpose. Each of us is unique. And it says, together, our response is to be faithful to God, our head. And it says, each person, and as each church, as each expression of the body of Christ, as we do our part, then Christ's work is carried out in our world. Sometimes we can look out there and think, yeah, it's impossible. How can anything change? It says, we, as the expression here, and as other parts of the body of Christ, serve the Lord as we're called to serve the Lord, that God's word, that God's work is accomplished in our world. I believe that God desires to do something wonderful and powerful through and among us, something that we can't do on our own, something that we're called to do, and something that he's going to empower us to do. If we only do what we think we can do ourselves, then we don't need God. We can do it ourselves. I believe God is going to empower us and help us and show us what he desires for us to do. As I was thinking about this, I was thinking, we believe that God has blessed us with lots of children for Sunday school. It's a very important mission of this church. And I'm thrilled. I spent time with the little guys this morning as Carrie was away. I'm thrilled as I see the young ones coming in, and there's been a lot of children come to Sunday school, and it's kind of neat to see as they're growing up and going into the older classes, hearing them respond as you interact with them, and now seeing them as they help with Bible school, do different things, and interacting with them, it's neat to see what God is doing in them. And we may never know the impact that this ministry, working with the children from our church, from some of the other churches, as well as our community, we may never know the impact that this ministry has in their lives. But we do it because God has brought them here, and we're being faithful to God. And I believe that it's something that we are expected to do, for now anyway, as long as the children keep coming. But yet we need to listen. We need to continue to listen and continue to pray. What is God? Are there other things that God is leading us into? Are there other things God is calling us to do? As we pray and seek guidance and direction, I believe that God will affirm to us what we are doing, but we can also dream new dreams, new visions of what God wants to do among us. And not just what we think we should do, but what God's calling us to do. Not the good things that we could do, but our unique purpose, the work that God will empower us to do, and that'll bring life and fruit for God's kingdom. And I believe that when we are doing that, that we are empowered to do that, and my hope is that it's not just one more thing to do, but it gives energy, and it brings life, and it draws us together as part of the body of Christ. But how do we know what we should do? How do we know? Well, I want to look at a story this morning found in the Old Testament. It's 2 Chronicles 20. And it's a story of someone who didn't know what they were supposed to do either. And this story tells what they do. So I'm going to invite Orlando and Joel to come and help tell this story. 2 Chronicles 20. It doesn't matter if you're loud enough. The armies of the Moabites, Ammonites, and some of the Meunites. When I see that Meunites, I think Mennonites. The armies of the Moabites, Ammonites, and some of the Meunites declared war on Jehoshaphat. Messengers came and told Jehoshaphat,
"The vast army from Edom is coming, is marching against you from beyond the Dead Sea. They're already at Engedi."
Jehoshaphat was alarmed by this news and sought the Lord for guidance. He also gave orders that everyone throughout Judah should observe a fast. So people from all the towns of Judah came to Jerusalem to seek the Lord. Jehoshaphat stood before the people of Judah and Jerusalem in front of the new courtyard at the temple of the Lord, and he prayed,
"O Lord God,
as all the men of Judah stood before the Lord with their little ones, wives, and children, the Spirit of the Lord came upon one of the men standing there, Jehaziel, a Levite. He said,
"Listen, King Jehoshaphat, listen, all you people of Judah and Jerusalem. This is what the Lord says. Don't be afraid, don't be discouraged by this mighty army, for the battle isn't yours, but God's. Tomorrow march against them. They will be climbing up by the passes in the desert of Jerusalem.
Then Then King Jehoshaphat bowed down with his face to the ground, and all the people of Judah and Jerusalem did the same thing, worshiping the Lord. Then the Levites stood up to praise the Lord, the God of Israel, with a very loud shout. Early the next morning, the army of Judah went out into the wilderness of Tekoa. On the way, Jehoshaphat stopped and said,
"Listen to me, all you people of Judah and Jerusalem. Believe in the Lord your God, and you will be able to stand firm. Believe in his prophets, and you will succeed."
After consulting the leaders of the people, the king appointed singers to walk ahead of the army, singing to the Lord and praising him for his holy splendor. This is what they sang.
"Give thanks to the Lord. His faithful love endures forever."
At the moment they began to sing and give praise, the Lord set up ambushes against the armies of Ammon, Moab, and Mount Seir, who were invading Judah, and they were defeated. So King Jehoshaphat receives a report that there's a vast army coming against him. It's an accurate report. It's an accurate description of the situation, and he also knows that it's a hopeless situation for him. But Jehoshaphat doesn't let the circumstances defeat him. He doesn't settle for what he can see. He's determined to fix his eyes not on what he could see, but on what he couldn't see. And that is a verse that I mentioned last week from 2 Corinthians 4:18, that we fix our eyes not on what is we can see, but what is unseen, because what is eternal will last. Jehoshaphat knows that he and his country belong to God, that they're God's people. If you read earlier in the story, you'll see how Jehoshaphat had led the people to follow God. He believed that God was with him. He believed that he could trust God, and so, in the midst of a difficult situation, he turns to God, and he proclaims a fast. He calls the people that can to come to Jerusalem to fast and pray, and he inquires of the Lord, and I love his prayer. His prayer, if you go back and read it again, that's 2 Chronicles chapter 20. He talks about who God is. If you want to know how to pray, look at Jehoshaphat's prayer. First, he talks about who God is. He talks about what God has done in the past. He talks about God's faithfulness. He talks about the way God has taught them through their leaders how they're to come before him to pray. And when they're in need, he acknowledges the present situation. He acknowledges their helplessness. And he ends with, "We don't know what to do, but our eyes are on you. Our eyes are on you." What a wonderful example of how to pray. And God answers. And God speaks through one of the people who are present there, who are fasting and praying. And God says to them, "Don't be afraid. Don't be discouraged. God is with you." And he gives directions for them and what to do. And Jehoshaphat and the people bow down and they praise God. And then in faith and in obedience, they follow what God tells them to do. It's ironic, they even send the choir ahead of the army as they go out to meet their enemy. A choir that sings praise to God, "Give thanks to the Lord, for his love endures forever." And we're told that God fights the battle for them, and they're saved. And at the end, they again gather to praise God for his goodness. When they needed guidance, when they needed direction, they went to God in prayer. And God answered. God answered. And I believe that when we come to God in prayer, God will answer us as well. And I encourage us to do the same thing that they did. I encourage us over the next few weeks to take time to fast and pray. Pray for God to show us his plans and his purposes. Remind God of what he's done in the past. Some of you haven't been here as long as others, but we can see what God has done, even in the time we've been here. Remind him of that. Praise God for that. Praise God for his faithfulness and for his goodness. Acknowledge that we need God. We don't know what to do, but our eyes are fixed on you. Our eyes are fixed upon the Lord. If you can, and I know there are reasons why some people can't, if you can replace a meal in a week, fast. And make that mealtime a time of prayer and praise and study of God's word. If you can't fast, still take special time in the next weeks to pray, to read God's word. And I encourage us to ask some questions as we pray. God, what are you calling us to do for you in the next year? What is your plans and purposes for us in the next year? And how can we best respond to you to accomplish these purposes in our situation and in our context? And then as we pray, listen. Listen. I encourage us not to be concerned about getting the right words. God sees our heart. He sees our sincerity. He sees our faith. He tells us in Romans that the Spirit intercedes within us when we can't even use words. When we pray sincerely, we can expect that God will answer. Jehoshaphat's prayer wasn't real formal, and it wasn't even real long. But he came to God and presented the need. Remember, you are a part of this body with Christ as our head. The Spirit of God flows through you. We can hear from God together. When Jehoshaphat prayed, his heart was in the right place. He desired to hear God speak to him, to give guidance to him and his people. And God spoke through one person there, we're told, as they prayed. I believe that God can speak through all of us to give us all pictures. This past week, as I've been really praying and seeking God, I have got some pictures, and I'm interested as we pray together how these pictures come together. Together we can rest assured that God will answer. God desires for us to experience his presence with us. He desires to show us his ways. He desires to reveal himself to us. He desires to work through us. We are his hands and his feet and his voice. It's through us that Jesus is revealed to our world. Jeremiah 33:3, God says, "Call to me, and I will answer you and tell you great and unsearchable things you don't know." May we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but what is unseen. For what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal. Let's pray together. Oh God, I thank you that even although you are God and you could snap your fingers or you could speak a word and things would happen, that most of the time, you don't do that. You use us. What an awesome privilege to know that you use us. And I pray, oh God, that as we meet this afternoon and in the next weeks, that as we pray, as we come before you, I pray that you will show us what your desire is for us as a community. What are the things that we can do that will bring life, that will bring fruit, that will be an encouragement to us as a body and in our community as well. Pray that you would show us your ways, that we may fulfill our plan, our purposes for you. Thank you again for each one here, O God. I pray that you will go with us again into this week. I pray that you will surprise us along the way with what you desire to do through us. Lord, may we be aware that you are there, you are with us, and that it is through us that Jesus is revealed to the world. Thank you, Father, again for this time together. Pray your blessing on each one in Jesus' precious name. Amen.